Welcome to Collector's Corner, the premier digital art platform.
We help collectors gain and maintain their edge, all while appreciating beautiful art.
Let's jump in.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Collector's Corner. We have another artist spotlight. I'm super excited because we have the fantastic on the rise rocket ship, Lars Wander, with us today. He's probably uncomfortable that I'm saying all these things about him, but this is how I feel. And my name is P. You may know me online at AskHimCloud. I'm here again with the wonderful Lars Wander. How are you doing today, Lars?
Really, really good. I'm thrilled to be here. I love doing these kinds of things. So thanks for having me.
Yeah, we are thrilled to have you. And I will tell you that the community really has been wanting to hear from you. Your, you know, dare I call it breakout collection, How You See Me, has been like a buzz amongst certainly the Graylers community, and I would say the generative art community more broadly. And then on top of that, you've recently been releasing some incredible work and progresses that have people losing their minds trying to figure out how they can get it. And, you know, is this going to be your bright moment to Tokyo, which congrats on that as well coming up. So a lot of exciting stuff on the generative art side, but you know, we would like to talk about you as and hear your story, how you got to here and kind of where you want to go. So maybe we can start with your background. I did a little LinkedIn sleuthing, but maybe you can tell folks like, well, what's your day job like?
Yeah. So I work at Google right now, although it's funny timing. I think at the time that this episode's dropping, I'm going to be no longer working there. I recently handed in my 2 weeks notice, and with the intent being of pursuing this artwork full time. But actually, it's been hard to leave the job because I genuinely enjoy what I do there, and I think it's also really interesting. And there's a cool synergistic effect with the artwork there, where what our team does is we sort of joke that our job is to draw pretty pictures, and that's kind of our primary output. But we work in the storage organization, and specifically sort of in the very bottom part of the stack there, dealing with how data gets written to disks. And we write visualization tools that try to sort of create visual metaphors for the behavior of these very large, complicated, distributed global scale systems, where like your more traditional techniques like drawing line charts and bar graphs and looking at log messages doesn't scale to the size that that Google has. And so instead we have this small team that builds sort of research-esque visualization and analysis tools that allow the site reliability engineers and the software engineers and the data analysts to get a better handle on what my boss likes to call the intrinsic behavior of these systems. So we try and find ways to take and re-represent how these systems are behaving at scale, and then draw them in the browser and make them interactive and paint a picture like that.
That's fantastic. And you know, it's funny, as I was telling you before, I was working in consulting and I got really good at Excel, but then I tried to learn Python. I didn't tell you this part. And I realized like, I can't even see what I'm doing here. Like you take for granted that visualization is baked in into the tools that are for more everyday users. And you're talking at probably like 10 orders of magnitude greater amount of information that you're having to put together and perhaps help people debug or figuring out what's going on. And were you in that department the whole time, or is that a recent development?
Yeah, it's first off, I like the comment you made about sort of assuming that visualization is baked in. And I like that you say that, because one thing we find is that some of our users are actually, our best users are very visualization oriented. And those are my favorite users because they love our tools, but not everyone's like that. Some people just really love the sort of symbolic and textual representation of data. But no, to answer your second question, I joined this team right at the start of the shelter in place period during the COVID-19 pandemic. And that was actually also when I sort of became aware peripherally of generative art or really computer art in general, where before that I'd spent some time working on an open source team, and then I spent some time as the tech lead for cloud speech to text, which is like a transcription service where it takes audio and returns what's being said in that audio. And then found this team sort of through happenstance, where I happened to use one of the tools that was built by the team and had a real kick using it because I thought it was really fun. It was representing some deployment data in a very unique and visual way, and got to talking to the manager. And then a few years later, he reached out and said they had an opening, and that was right around when I joined.
That's awesome. Okay. I have a bunch of different places I want to take this, but maybe just really quickly before we go back to the start, how does it feel to have made that decision to put in the 2 weeks notice? And are you excited? Are you nervous? What's going through your mind and heart right now?
Yeah, I feel like it hasn't totally sunk in yet. I think on one hand, I guess all the things you said, I'm excited, nervous, all of these. I think more than anything, though, I feel like over time, I was feeling more and more like this opportunity to take art seriously and do it full time is something that probably only really get one shot to in my lifetime. It's kind of a very unique time and place for this particular type of art. I feel more than anything that if I didn't take this opportunity, that in 20 years or so, I'd probably feel a lot of regret that if I never really got to explore what it was like to really put all of my creative energy into doing this, where really up until now, like I've loved doing my day job so much, but two, it's also fairly intensive and requires a lot of work. I really haven't been able to dedicate myself completely, or at least dedicate all of my creative energy to making this artwork. And I feel like I have like a million ideas of things I want to build, and I'm like so thrilled to get to explore them that I think more than anything feel grateful that I can do this, because it's kind of absurd to me that this is even a possibility or even potentially a career path. It hasn't really totally clicked that it's something that I can get paid to do. But because of that, it's like, it feels kind of marvelous and kind of wonderful. And there's like a lot of, I don't know, like a sense of magic around it that that hasn't really worn off yet. And I hope never wears off, because I feel like that's where all the enjoyment comes from.
Yeah. I completely understand where you're coming from. It's funny, as I get to talk to artists like yourself, I feel similarly, but I get to talk about art and this is my day job and get to meet interesting people. And the community is so good, and I hope it stays this way, but really supportive. The people like you are fantastic. People like artxcode, we were talking about Sophia before, and all the collectors. I mean, really just like high quality folks right now building out this world that I think of as like we're building the digital parallel of the art world, similar to how crypto's built the digital parallel to the finance world, or is building it, early stages. And I think the opportunity to be a part of that in any capacity, artist, builder, even collector, I think is just really exciting for us. But I'll stop rambling about myself. You're clearly a fantastic software engineer to be at Google. Everyone knows that. How has art played a part in your life, or when did it start playing a part in your life?
I think I can pretend to be a passable software engineer. I think that's one thing I've learned, but that's sort of me at best. But as far as art goes, I think ever since I was a little kid, I was always fascinated with drawing. As I got older, I got really into making movies on like little home camcorders with kind of crappy desktop software for editing, but have them like stashed away in a secret YouTube channel, which hopefully no one ever finds. But and then for a while,
if they find those, they're gonna sell for a lot. You know, it's
no, they're
this
not.
World is crazy.
I think all my art will be severely devalued if they find those YouTube videos. But I all the while was really fortunate. My parents put me into guitar lessons when I was a kid, so I sort of grew up with like a strong music influence, which then at some point evolved into writing my own music, which was like a very, very interesting and I think also very informative creative practice. And then for a while in New York, I got really into street photography, which I think like was in part driven by like a fascination with like gear and photography equipment, which is a lot of fun. I think a lot of people can relate to, but also I found that at least on the outset, that street photography was a very interesting way to push me to sort of get out of my shell and explore the city a little bit more. But then very quickly evolved into a fascination with the practice and a real sort of respect for the artists that do it well evolved from that too. Like, for example, I talked about this in my AOI masterclass, but like Daniel Arnold, for example, is just, in my opinion, one of the greats, and he produces such like not necessarily immediately visually stunning, but like very deep and fascinating and playful and almost like flirtatious photography that capture very candid and very organic, unscripted, but bizarre moments just in New York City that sort of really captured me and pulled me in. And it sounds maybe kind of cliche, but it's there that I learned that like a piece of art doesn't have to be pretty to be good or to be interesting. And it's much more important to have something interesting and engaging at a level deeper than just the initial visual aesthetic that at least to me makes a piece of artwork compelling. And then it wasn't really until the pandemic that I got into any sort of visual, or not visual, but maybe more traditional artwork where, again, it's maybe not traditional, but I got a pen plotter, and that turned into like a deep rabbit hole of like just playing with it day in and day out, where I was locked in my tiny apartment and the pen plotter sort of kept me company for that time. And I was plotting endlessly and exploring and exploring. And then at some point sort of felt like it felt like a little confining. Like at first it was interesting to have that as like a creative constraint, like having on one hand the precision of the machine, but also like the lack of maybe what's the right word, like dexterity that the machine can really exert. That sort of drove me to wanting to play more with really just computer artwork, where you have sort of in a sense unlimited control over every single pixel, and you can compose whatever sort of image you want to. And that's what drove me into, I guess, the kind of work that I've been making recently.
I appreciate you talking about your background and how you had these creative practices, whether it was music or making the videos and getting into photography. I'm curious, given that, why did you decide to go into engineering? Which I think now, as we're emerging, certainly in this generative art world, we don't think of engineering as being a non-creative practice. And I think most engineers who are actually doing it know that it's not a creative practice, or sorry, it is a creative practice. But when, at least I was growing up in school, it was not portrayed that way, right? It was like, you kind of have the arts, which were these cool creative things, but like never made money. And then you had like the kind of engineering, science, and like business stuff that were, I don't know, maybe less creative. I know this is probably like some of my baggage from a child that, but I was curious, like, yeah, what drew you to the technical side?
Yeah. I think 100% it was the fact that my dad's a physicist, and then he's but working as a programmer, and sort of being exposed to computers from a very young age. I think he jokes that when I first learned to spell my name, I would say it's L-A-R-S return for like the enter key, which I guess I could see how, like as a dad, that's probably very funny to see your kid spelling your name like that. But yeah, I think I just, from like a very young age, like having him as an influence and seeing like the technical side is something like very interesting and engaging, just also made that very fun. Like I think that I was like very fascinated with computers from a young age, and Sort of the more I got into it and like went to go study it in school, the more I enjoyed it and the more I really gained an appreciation for, I think, the engineering side of it and the mathematical side of it, which is still like kind of very deeply magical to me too, like what goes on there. It's not like maybe we think of like computers as like predictable or as like cold and understandable, but there's like the frontiers of it, and even at the stuff that you can explore with on your own desktop, there's like really marvelous things you can do with a computer, and they're like in some ways like deeply unpredictable, and that's something that like I hope to explore and express with my artwork, and that's one of the things that I feel like I'm so lucky to get to do there.
Yeah, I gotta tell you, that's a beautiful analogy, I think, for generative art, right? Because to some extent, you are giving up control, and the what you end up with visually is a little bit unexpected. And I think of I studied engineering in my undergrad as well. I was biomed engineering, so I didn't get as deep into the computer science, but I've always thought that what we see, you know, we're captivated by certain things. Like I really love images of nature and being in nature. And it, my mind, that's all some kind of a code, right? And it's not like it's exactly defined. You have some primitives that can then manifest in all sorts of different ways, like infinite combinations effectively. And in that way, I think there is something beautiful about it and the math that goes into it. So I hear you on that and definitely resonate with that. And as you were talking about just a few minutes ago, how you kind of transitioned into plotters during the start of the pandemic, was that the first time you were making art with your computer or with code, or had you dabbled with it? I mean, my guess is you had dabbled a little bit if you went to the step of buying a plotter, but I'm curious when you started really harnessing the code as the medium.
Yeah, well, I feel like even maybe for the first year, what I was doing with my plotter, I wouldn't even really consider it as art. I would like show my friends, and they would say like, "Oh, you're making art," and I'm like, "No, it's not artwork. It's just like playing with a pen plotter." And I think it's still like maybe a kind of tough question. Like, I don't know, what is art? What isn't art? I think that's, I don't know, silly distraction. But I think what I did before, I played with like programming on the side for doing, I guess, all sorts of maybe weird experimentation, but it was almost never visual. And I, in retrospect, have no idea why not. I feel like now, like, the connection's obvious and it makes complete sense. But for the most part, like, most of my experiments are sort of based around computer languages and like writing strange interpreters or compilers and these kinds of things, which I think there's like an artistic element to that too, you could say. And I think that like programming language design can be very heavily influenced by aesthetics, oddly enough. But and I think that that's also why it sort of sparks some very fierce debates and some strongly held opinions in the computer community, the whole topic of programming languages. But no, I think that just for whatever reason, seeing the pen plotter run and knowing that it was driven by something as simple as like XY coordinates, where you say like, move over here, move the pen down, move over here, move the, like lift the pen off, move over here. I was like, oh, it's probably fun just to write programs for that. Like, let's see what happens. And like, so what I did when I ordered the pen plotter was I, before it even arrived, started writing a library both to visualize the predicted output of the program. So it's like easy enough to do, because you can like on an HTML canvas, just draw the same lines that the plotter is going to draw. And then also a little library to drive the plotter using those, that same sequence of commands. And then when the plotter arrived, it was, it's like, I guess also a testament to just how easy to use and how robust these AxiDraw units are by evil mad scientists, that I plugged it in and it kind of immediately started working. And that was like a real source of joy, and kind of just like carried on from there basically.
Oh man, that's so cool. And so how long was it until you thought, you know what, let me try to put this out there beyond just friends and family?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I started posting them to Instagram pretty early on just for fun, because I think like before that I was posting my street photography and Before that, I was like posting music to SoundCloud. So I think like I never really minded sharing stuff. I knew that it was never like fully baked or professional or like necessarily, like especially starting out, it's never at like the level of quality that you expect from yourself. But I feel like that process of sharing it's like kind of fun because I think something that I really enjoy is like finding some persona online and seeing that they still have like various bits of their digital life uploaded and you can see their progression. So I think like I kind of intentionally figure like, hey, why not just upload this stuff? Maybe one day either I'll be happy to go back and look at this and say like it's fun to see where it started. Or maybe it doesn't ever amount to anything and it just kind of sits out there forever. Or maybe to someone else, like it can be kind of interesting to go back and see like, yeah, when you start, like your stuff doesn't look great. Or maybe it's not good by any objective definition from the start, but part of the process. And it's kind of fun just to learn and play with and use it as like a tool for feeding your own curiosity.
Yeah, absolutely. So you're putting these online. And when did it turn where you said, okay, well, maybe I should put on a show or try to sell some of this? Can you walk us through that transition?
It was kind of funny. I have this one friend, Misha, who he's like 5 steps ahead in his ideas. And he was on to NFTs maybe before, like in early 2020, before they really had a name for themselves. I think he was onto them even before then, but when he saw what I was doing with the water, he was like, Lars, you have to make NFTs for these because it's like exactly what you're doing. Like the plots are almost inherently fungible because you can replot them until you associate them with a non-fungible token, where now that plot becomes like an item that's that has like a uniqueness, or it's like now a one of one in a sense, I guess, using the current terminology when you associate it with a token. So I like decided to learn Solidity, and I wrote like a very tiny ERC-721 contract and deployed it using, forgetting what it was, it's like the popular Python framework for deploying this stuff, but yeah, I'm totally blanking on the name, but yeah, I deployed it and uploaded like 5 different pieces and sent them out to friends. And that was even before I guess I decided to try to sell any of it. I think the first, I sold like one single piece. I made like a Shopify store or something and like uploaded a piece. And then overnight, one of my friends bought it. And I was like, oh, this is exciting. And I'm like, oh, I have to deal with like shipping it and packing it. And I can't really charge enough for me to feel like it's really worth my time to do this full time because it's like the very first artwork I ever sold. So I figured I'd like slow down on selling it because the whole like mechanical process around like, actually getting the works out there, it's fairly involved, and I figured it'd be more fun just to play with it. So at that point, it wasn't really about making money. It was just about sort of exploring. And I think like later in 2021, around Thanksgiving time, FX Hash was really starting to take off. And at that point, I was already familiar with everything going on in Artblocks. And I was like, oh, this is amazing. I really want to like try to make a long form collection. Haven't really tried anything like this before, and FX Hash was kind of like the perfect medium. I think many people had the same feeling at that time, where they sort of saw this as an opportunity to sort of test out the medium and get their name out there and try making some generative artwork. And that's where I released a few collections based on some ideas that I guess I'd sort of been brewing over time. And I intentionally listed the prices as very, very low. They're like 2 TEZ or something. Just because I didn't feel like I could possibly charge anymore, and I definitely couldn't at the time either. Really just had fun sort of seeing them get created and seeing people get excited about them, and that sort of feeds the cycle of getting more excited about it myself. And yeah, that's how I got into selling these.
Yeah, and I'm, you know, my collector brain is buzzing hearing about these early ERC 721s that you put out there. Are they still out there? Are there some folks with the original Lars Wanders out there?
Yeah, they also have them. They're, I think 3 of them are with close friends, and 1 of them are with someone that like helped me understand Solidity a little better. So I told them I would just send them the token and the plot. And yeah, they're out there. So I don't know what's going on with them, or or if they're still in good shape, but in theory, they live out there.
Well, we know the NFT is still in good shape, right? That's a what won't degrade. Yeah, don't let them sell those. Do not let them sell those, because collectors will be trying to find them, I'm sure. And it's funny what you were talking about. It's so, I don't know if ironic is the right word, but that the analog part is the part that annoys us. We're like, ah, like shipping and like dealing with like USPS or whatever. You know, it's funny how the digital, I mean, and of course, like we love the prints. I got my first print, a new house, the wall's a little bit bare, but hopefully in the next few weeks, I'll have some art up here. It's amazing, but it's just so interesting that it's, you know, once you experience moving these things around and buying and selling them digitally, it's just so much easier than dealing with the analog side, despite that satisfaction from the analog.
I know, it's almost a shame, right? Like, I think that I think the biggest barrier to me though was the fact that, like, at least at the time when I started, I think I sold the plot for like $100, which is already a lot of money, but it's not enough, I think, at the time for me to say like, okay, I'm going to make my full-time job selling maybe a handful of $100 plots a week, because that's just not economically feasible. But I think for the right pieces and for the right works, especially the plotter works, like I think the physical component is very important to me. And I think that it's important that it gets into the collector's hands, and that when they sell their token, that the physical also transfers with them, which have, I guess, like two collections now that are plotted, where there's a token and an accompanying physical piece. And every time I see a token transfer ownership, and then the new collectors say like, oh, I reached out and they're sending me the piece, I get so happy, because I feel like it's not guaranteed to happen, but every time it does happen, I think it's a wonderful thing, because it's really a part of the, it's kind of, I guess it's an experiment in a sense, because you never know how these things are going to go going forward. But I do feel strongly about that.
No, for sure. And I think that we as collectors love that as well. Actually, one of my friends recently, he's been waiting for a long time, he'll be happy to hear this, DeFi staker, he got his hands on a Lions Walking, and I think he was able to find the seller and is going to receive the print as well. Sorry if I got that wrong, DeFi, but yeah, it's really cool for us to have it. Honestly, I think it's just a matter of the logistics, and increasingly those are improving. But I will tell you, and maybe me like this, that I want to get to the world where I have my plotter at home and I can buy your NFT and just plot it like right then and there. And then I don't know about the framing part. I guess I'll still have to outsource that, but then just be able to have it immediately. I think that would be so cool. And hopefully we get there in the next 5 years or so.
Yeah, I totally encourage you to buy a plotter. unless you don't have one already, I think you should totally get one. They're a blast to play.
I don't. I poured all my money to this podcast, so I'm low-key hoping that a plotter company will send me one to test it out, so I can go ahead and let folks know about it. The jokes aside, I think I would get one, although I, of course, would not say no to a free one. So if anyone's listening, just let me know.
Even that scientist is listening, then we can.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so that's amazing. You started to get all of this attention for your work because it's beautiful, and justifiably so. And we mentioned this. One thing I wanted to ask you really quickly before we dive into your work and kind of your artistic intent and thoughts behind it is, we talked about you were working with artxcode, and I wanted to bring this up for the artists listening as well, because I have artists reach out to me, I have friends of artists reach out, other collectors, and they say, hey, like, especially when they really start becoming more prominent, I'm sure there's a million opportunities coming at you. Hey, Lars, come do this show, that show. We want you to like curate something or do a generative series of this and that. My sense is that it can be difficult to navigate for anybody, let alone someone who is new to selling their art. What made you decide to work with artxcode, and kind of how's that experience been? And this is really, I think, more so for the artists out there who might be listening, but I'd love to hear your perspective.
Yeah, so true. I'll say first right off the bat that I would say artxcode is worth every penny. They're fantastic. Sophia and Tony and then Josh on my team too are really just great to have as resources and as a part of my team, and to work with them is just it's really great. They know what they're doing, and they're really top notch. I first heard about artxcode when Sophia organized and put on the digital, which is this big exhibit they did during Art Basel in Miami, I think 2021. And I think it's like one of those real like standout shows where they did just a fantastic job of presenting all of these physical pieces that were, or sorry, digital pieces that were starting to really attract a lot of attention. Like they'd shown up in, I think, like a Sotheby's or Christie's auction, and at the time hadn't really been presented in a really nice way, like maybe using tiny screens or the wrong aspect ratios and poorly lit rooms, and it's kind of a shame to the art. And I think Sophia sort of made it her mission to really present the artwork in a way that she felt the artwork deserved, and I think she did a fantastic job there. And so I saw this, like it was on Instagram, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. Like what an incredible, incredible show. Like this Sophia Garcia lady is really talented. I didn't at the time imagine I would ever have the opportunity to get to work with her. But around the same time, I also started to build the relationship with Tony, and that's his online pseudonym, is Tony Marinara. Here, I guess if you've heard of.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Tony. He's in Graylers. We chat all the time and stuff. So yeah.
He's fantastic. But he was the first person actually outside of like my social circle to feel like really get excited about my artwork. I shared on Twitter a picture of this piece, Splat 3FN, which was what later became or was sort of inspiration for the How You See Me series. He like immediately commented and saying like, can you please mint this? I have to buy this. And I was like, okay, I guess. Like, I can't imagine why you'd want to do that. But so I minted it on Tezos, and I think he like created his first Tez wallet, because before that he was always collecting on Ethereum. And he like created 10 editions and for like one Tez each, and he bought them all overnight. And then I was like, who is this guy? Like, why does he, like, it's one, very sweet of him, but two, like, very surprising to me. But every time we got to talking and I got to know him better, and like, he's like a very, very intelligent guy, very, very thoughtful, and has like a clearly defined taste when he's collecting, and can articulate really well why he likes a piece and how he feels that it fits into maybe the broader landscape. And I basically, the more I got to know him, the more I liked him, and really just started using him as a resource, asking him questions like, hey, like if I release this thing, like how do you think I should price it? Like, who are people that might buy it? More and more, I felt like he was, just really helping me out with making connections and giving me great advice that I was telling him, like, Tony, you should start an art gallery. Like, you have a huge collection of artwork. Two, so many artists adore you. And then three, you have all this great advice to give. And apparently at around the same time, I think he was having similar conversations with Marcel and with Martin Grasser. And basically all of this combined to him, the key piece I'm leaving out here is that through his wife, he's been close friends with Sophia for some time, which, crazy coincidence, then led to him signing on with artxcode and quitting his job as a corporate lawyer. Like, very, I think, like a hard thing to quit, I imagine, because these things pay very well and they're very prestigious.
But in some ways hard, probably in some ways easy to quit.
Yeah, I think from what he's described, it's also a tough job to have, and he's probably been very grateful to switch to something that I guess he's more interested in the subject to begin with. But so he basically came to me and he said, Lars, I'm joining artxcode as a representative and I'd love to have you on if you want to be on my team. I was like, oh my god, yeah, like absolutely, that sounds fantastic. And then I signed with him officially. So there's like a contract and everything. And that was maybe about half a year ago at this point. And no, they're fantastic because like they have a great understanding of the space. They have a great understanding of who the various collectors are, what the opportunities are. Like it's Sophia and Tony, for example, got me onto Super Rare without me having to do any work. Just one day an email showed up and said, you're on Super Rare. I was like, this is great. Isn't it? Like these kinds of things that they can do. And it's really wonderful. Of course, to any artist listening, I think you have to, if you want to sign with a gallery or with someone to do these things with you, I think you have to obviously trust them and you have to know that they have your best interests at heart. And that's one thing that's really wonderful about artxcode too, is I think there's been many opportunities where they could have like squeezed me or Marty or Itzel for more money or for to push us to grow faster. But they 100% like have a very long-term focused view and are very, very much have our interests at heart, which is like a really wonderful thing, and they're good people.
Yeah, that's amazing. And I'm really glad that they're in the ecosystem and helping folks navigate, because you know, we even as collectors will see stuff that sometimes artists do and we're like, oh, don't do that. And it's like hard, I'm sure hard to find a trusted person, and the space is so new. I mean, we talk to folks who have been successful in the traditional art world, and it's a little bit of a different game here in the Web3 art world, as I'm sure it's different if you're doing an exhibition with like, you know, a part in real life, part Web3 type of deal. So there's a lot of nuances, and I'm sure it helps you just focus on the art, which is great. Perhaps just one last point on this. Are there any lessons that come to mind? It could be one, it could be three, but anything that you would say to new artists who maybe don't have right now the opportunity to work with a group of folks like artxcode, and maybe something that you've picked up kind of working with them just through osmosis, like any tips for early folks getting started?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I would say, like maybe don't be afraid to say no to an opportunity. I think that, I mean, of course, if it's a fantastic opportunity and you've never seen one like it before, then absolutely jump on it. But I think that in this space, like the folks putting on the shows have to make money too, and they need artists and they need them to produce works by a certain amount of time. And it's very easy by saying yes to everything to oversubscribe yourself. And it's detrimental in two ways. One, like you can really reasonably only produce so much good work in a year. And two, like if you overproduce, whether it's work you're proud of or not, it'll probably saturate your own market. And that's not a helpful thing either. And I think it's good having Sophia and Tony there to sort of act as like pacemakers and to provide a pulse check to say like, hey, this is a great opportunity. But like, if you do it, then it's like right after this other big show you're doing, not a great idea. I'll go talk to them and negotiate a better day for you. And that's like, that's maybe something where, or not a great tip for someone who doesn't have a Sophia and Tony in their ring, but it's, I think, totally okay and fine to set your own pace and to find a pace that you're comfortable working at and don't feel like you're oversubscribed.
Yeah. And I'm glad you said that. I'll piggyback on that point, because I think that, look, if your art is great, they'll wait. And if they won't, there'll be someone else who is willing. Now, if it's, you know, art blocks curated, then you might be worth it to just kind of go with them. But they're also not the type to rush you in anything, from what I can tell and what I can see. And I think that you want to play, there's a saying in business, right? Like play long-term games with long-term people. And I think that applies to your collectors, that applies if you choose to get representation, that applies to artist collaborations, launch platforms, whatever. I think it feels like a universal rule. So that makes a lot of sense. And I think that's a fantastic one. And I'll just add one more, is do what Lars does and drip out really like awesome work in progresses. You could put those work in progresses out for months. And I mean, okay, you maybe don't want to stretch it out too long, and I'm sure you want to get to the finish of the project, but that's a fantastic way to build hype. I think that, you know, artists are, it's an interesting game coming on Web3, because you, have the ability to be your own self-promoter in a way that I think was much more difficult than before. You don't have to do it, but you can. And that certainly could be part of the game. But that is awesome advice. Thank you for sharing that in your experience there. I think as time goes on, that will be extremely valuable for folks to hear about. And like we said, it helps you focus on your art. So let's get into some of your art, man. We've been keeping the people waiting. Would you like to screen share?
I would love to. Let's see. I'm gonna close some extra tabs here.
As that is going up, I wanted to let people know Lars has a website, larswander.com. And if you go to the art section there, you can see a lot of his fantastic work. And, you know, Lars, I would love to hear about how your work progressed. I mean, the oldest one you have on here is called Ribbons, that does look like some of your plotter work. Now, is this some of the stuff you were doing back during the early days of the pandemic?
Yeah, this is, I mean, it's tough when you're putting together like a portfolio or a website to like decide what to include, because I feel like it's fun to share things that aren't even necessarily for sale too, because you want to just, I don't know, put stuff that you're excited about up here. So this is kind of a rough date of, I guess, when some of these pieces were made, but these ribbons, some of them were sold as a part of the Perry Mary Lars show, but none of the ones pictured here, these are still in my giant stack of old plots that's sitting up there somewhere. These kind of came from, I guess, like maybe you could call it like a dialogue or a conversation with a medium, where in pen plotting, like the atom or the smallest unit is like a single line that you draw with the machine, and that could be as small as a single point, and it can be as long as something that fills the whole page. But as you're sort of playing with the pen plotter and you're figuring out what you want to draw, you quickly realize that, well, one, putting too many lines in a single place will simply tear the page, and that's no good. It's kind of a funny limitation to run up against. But it's also often like aesthetically not very appealing to have a lot of crossing lines in many places, and that's something that maybe it's an artifact of our visual systems, and or maybe it's just there's some inherent truth to not having too many intersecting lines, because they don't look very good. But what I did with the ribbons was basically give every line that's drawn a width and a height, so they're sort of in a parametric sense, and it's like 3D world where they can now occlude one another. And what that lets you do, let's see if I can find a high resolution one here, is it lets you start to explore with what happens when you layer and intersect and draw all of these lines on top of each other. And this is a piece that I'm actually really quite fond of, because it looks, especially when you zoom in, like very chaotic and very messy, and you can sort of see where all these ribbons are in some cases intersecting with each other, in other cases they're kind of going over and under one another. However, this piece is actually three-way rotationally symmetric, and if you look at the exact center, which is right here, you can see that pretty much everywhere there's these triangles that form at varying scales. And the piece is really just kind of like you normally take a tapestry where you have two sheets and you sort of interweave them like this. In this case, you just have three, and you get like a abstract computer tapestry weaving, which I guess is something that, more generally speaking, I find so fun and exciting about the computer art world, which is that you can take systems that we're sort of familiar with in everyday life and then re-represent them in code, and then tweak the parameters to get them into a state where they're physically impossible, but somehow still possible in the state of the computer system. It's kind of like taking these things and turning them on their head in a very grounded and logical way, but in a way that's completely absurd and impossible at the same time. And I find that juxtaposition very beautiful.
And how do you marry that with wanting to actually plot the piece, right? Because you're creating this, let's call it this structure that is impossible in the real world, but then how do you get it to represent in a meaning or a logical way in real life?
Yeah, great question. I feel like that's kind of the fun with the pen plotter is you get to breathe life into these things by taking something that maybe was previously impossible, but then representing it in a two-dimensional space where suddenly you can sort of peer at it from one angle and you can kind of get, it's kind of like taking like a four-dimensional shape and casting a light on it and then looking at the two-dimensional shadow that gets created. Like, yeah, it's not something that can exist in our world, but the shadow can. And you can see this alternative perspective on this object that is impossible and maybe not even something that we can really even hold in our heads. But we can look at it from angles that maybe it starts to make sense or you can start to appreciate some of the beauty in it.
Yeah, no, this is giving me echoes back to like nth dimensional calculus being like, what is the fifth integral of something even mean? But I know what you're saying. And actually on that point, like how deep into the like math were you getting as you were exploring these different concepts that you wanted to play around with?
Yeah, good question. I think there's a whole like semi body of work that I haven't talked about much that it's because I haven't really gotten into a state where I'm very happy with, but it's probably where I went the deepest on the math front where there's this really fantastic library in Python called JAX, and that's J-A-X. Look it up here. JAX Python. And if you're familiar with NumPy, if you have any sort of maybe data science or machine learning background, NumPy it's a library for representing vectorized data and doing transformation on it with a Python interface that's maybe typically slow, but NumPy is incredibly fast. So you can do all sorts of very fancy things with it. But what's amazing with JAX is you can write NumPy code using the JAX NumPy interface, and you can compute like a quote unquote forward pass where you run some math, you do some computation. And if you want to, you can optionally compute all the partial derivatives for the output with respect to the input. So obviously the immediate application here is machine learning, and that's what this was developed for. But what I was trying to do with this was something inspired by Jonathan McCabe, who highly recommend. He's a brilliant artist, Jonathan McCabe. Look him up, jonathanmccabe.com. He's a computer artist who's doing stuff unlike really anyone else in the space, and super brilliant guy. He's been doing this for many years. Just love giving him shout outs because I feel like he's not appreciated enough in the space. But I talked to him about how he was producing a certain set of works, and he said he had basically competing objective functions that he was evaluating manually and written some tools to sort of, with like a human input, sort of guide these systems of equations into a happy state and produce very stunning visual outputs. And what I was trying to do with JAX was see if I can do it automatically using automatic differentiation and then using that differentiation to guide those two objective functions into a local minima that produced something interesting. But I spent maybe like 3 months working on this and nothing cool came out yet. I definitely want to go back to this and I think it'll make something really interesting one day. And I have certain ideas of how this can even be maybe tied into a long form project based on some heavy computation that happens beforehand that then gets uploaded into an Ethereum contract. But so far that hasn't yielded anything. So, but yeah, sometimes you go deep on the math and it doesn't yield anything. But if anything, I think it's maybe more going deep on the computer systems that's been happening here.
Yeah, no, this is super interesting. And I imagine that, well, I'll save it for later because I have some theories around the experimentation that's happening, the creativity that, you know, I just love this idea of pushing yourself creatively for one purpose and then somebody coming up a month, a year, 10 years, a decade later and repurposing that for some other use. Like to me, it's just so cool to see that. I mean, in the pharmaceutical industry, people are making drugs for one reason and they forget about them. And then 20 years later, they repurpose that drug and it's like a cure for something that was incurable. And I think that kind of thing really, generative art lends itself to that because you're creating all this cool stuff and who knows how that might be used for art or something else in the future. And also the, I forget the word is, but the Lego nature of code, right? Where you can just kind of build on itself, especially open source code is super cool. But people are going to kill me if I don't get back to the art. So going back to ribbons, you started playing around with the plotters. You create this beautiful shapes. I love that one that you showed. That actually was my favorite of the ones that were portrayed here on your website. What artistic thread did this uncover for you? And kind of where did you pull on next? Like what did ribbons lead into? You know, the next a grouping of projects you have here or works you have is called polygon packing, but I'd love to hear like, what did that inspire in you and how did that manifest into the next one? And then perhaps you could keep going as to like how your various projects unfolded and where they redirected you to.
Yeah, it's a great question. I feel like a lot of my exploration is like very breath first. Like it's kind of going into many directions at once. And, the ribbons yielded a lot of interesting outputs, and some of them were shown in this show here. I think, let's see, I have a whole set of them here. So actually, these outputs were created by that same ribbons algorithm, and they were plotted in graphite and produced these like very beautiful floral shapes that I had a lot of fun, one, producing outputs for, and then two, plotting, just because they're so delicate. Also produced all of these sets, these two sheets. So kind of the same way I was explaining that three rotationally symmetric piece. These aren't symmetric in the same way, but they are the same shape, but just rotated once. And then you find these like very interesting intersection patterns that then become made alive and visualized through code. And I really enjoy these. But I guess chronologically, what happened next, or what I was sort of exploring at the same time, was this polygon packing technique that, this is maybe an overloaded term, like I think depending on who you ask, this means different things, but like the process is explained here, and it's taking a shape and basically reflecting it over an arbitrary edge, depending, you can use different policies for selecting what the next edge is, and then looking at and seeing what the patterns are that you get. And it's one of those fun things where like at a small scale like this, like it doesn't seem very interesting and you don't really, like maybe it's not super inspiring, like okay, sure, like you take a triangle and you start flipping it over its edge. Like, yeah, it's kind of obvious you get like this kind of a shape. But what was really interesting was as you scaled it up and as you made it bigger and bigger, you started getting like some, I don't have an easy way to look at that. These like very rich grain structures that almost kind of mirror how you see these grain boundaries, for example, in metals. Look at them at the atomic level, you have these very large contiguous sheets that form regular crystal lattices, and then in certain places they abruptly change into a slightly differently oriented pattern. And I think that's one of those things that was very fun, where with the computer you can take something small and simple and scale it up and see how you go from small and simple and predictable to large and chaotic and sort of wonderfully unpredictable. And I really love these four-sided shapes here because they produce these, they almost look like those pavers that you sometimes see in some European countries where you have these kind of radial patterns that emanate when you have these four-sided tiles. I think they're called sets, actually. We have a link here. They look kind of like these. But this particular project was actually what inspired Geode, where I guess maybe it's a secret, maybe it's no secret, but this is my favorite project that I've released on FX Hash. And it's really fun to also see these in high res, where this is basically taking that same polygon packing technique, but it adds one extra element that I thought was really important to the series, which is the color of the shape comes from the edge on the preceding shape that it was reflected over. So if you have a repeating pattern where you repeatedly sort of flip over the same pair of edges or the same trifecta of edges, you get a part of the piece that is colored or patterned identically. So you have these kind of quasi grain structure like shapes and patterns emerging, and you get these really rich textures, which I think if you look at them live here, let's see if we run it.
By the way, this is a crowd favorite too. So I think the crowd will love to hear that this is also your favorite on FX Hash over here. While this is loading, I'm curious, in that natural structure, as you described, do you get sort of segments of the patterning repeating, but then adjacent to it, you have something different and you're seeing them render here. How do you dictate whether the pattern continues or if it reverts to a different patterning adjacently? Essentially, like, how do the stripes or patterns create? Is it just random that the next one has a higher chance of being that same pattern if it's next to it, but there is a chance that it changes or something like that?
No, great question. No, it's actually completely emergent from I guess the structure of the code or the structure of what it's simulating. What it's trying to do is it's always trying to pick whichever edge is available for fitting a shape. So if there's no shape that you can fit, like for example, like here it looks like there's no room for a shape, so nothing was packed there. But as long as there's room on an edge closest available to whatever point it's trying to grow towards, so here it was clearly growing from the top left corner to the bottom right corner, it just picks that edge and then continues the pattern. And then the actual structures that emerge and the shapes that you get are completely an artifact of how the code's evaluating. So it's I think this is one of those things where, like, I personally love this kind of stuff where you have a little bit of creative control at the start, like you're telling it to sort of behave with these sort of high level rules that maybe dictate the behavior at a very small scale. But then the overall structures that emerge are really just a byproduct of the code and the evaluation of the system.
Yeah, and as you're making these, or even going back to ribbons, I mean, it strikes me that like ribbons and now polygon packing, which as you're describing led into geode, do you have a clear source of inspiration for these? You know, is it like, I mean, you mentioned the cobblestone patterning that you see in some places in Europe, or, you know, are you starting with something that you've experienced in real life and then trying to back into it? Or is it really just kind of a pure exploration of the code that, and you're, some things catch your eye or your mind and you keep going with it?
Yeah, no, great question. I feel like it's tough because there's like never like one consistent source where I guess like the ideas or their inspiration comes from. It's always maybe something random. I don't think that the tiles were necessarily the inspiration going into it, but maybe more something that I realized after the fact. In this case, it was, I think it comes from like, in, sometimes it's doodling in a sketchbook and sort of thinking from the perspective of like, well, what's possible to program, even if it's sometimes kind of challenging. And this was actually probably one of the most like mind melting things to code because of just how many unbelievably tedious degenerate cases there are when you're dealing with intersections between shapes that have to be very precise. Especially when it's the same shape reflected over itself. There's all sorts of cases where if you sort of naively do the intersection, you can miss cases where all the vertices are touching and there's no lines that are intersecting, for example. Or a shape is laying edge to edge. It's like all the edges are on top of each other and they're not actually intersecting. There's all sorts of very strange cases where you have an intersection, and if you drew it, it would be obvious it's an intersection. And unless you, if you're doing like a naive sort of edge detection, you'll miss it. And if you do it more robustly, it'll be too slow and too expensive. So this one was tedious. Like, is what I'm saying is, it's possible to program. Sometimes it's painful, and that process of programming it can sometimes be a source of joy. Sometimes it's a source of like head banging on the keyboard for a while because you're like, it works great, and then like the 2000th piece like doesn't work and you see like two pieces overlapping and you're like, why? Which anyone who's programmed can relate to. And
sure, debugging these generative systems is its own beast.
Yeah, like some bugs are good and interesting because they produce unexpected outputs, and other ones are like clearly bad. I mean, I guess it's all subjective in the end, but I think if in this series, two of these pieces had overlapped in a way that was immediately visually obvious, then I would say that's kind of a failure. So it's, yeah, it's somewhat subjective, somewhat not.
Yeah, absolutely. So, okay, you're continuing your exploration of POG unpacking with Geode, which again, fantastic, came out wonderfully. And yeah, it sort of looks like the paint mixing was a separate study, not so much plotter related, not as geometric. How did you get into that? Or was that just always going on the side and you're exploring these things simultaneously?
Yeah, no, the paint mixing also, I guess, came from like the same general idea of like, there's gotta be a way to program this like some way or another. And the early approach that I took was entirely CPU bound and very slow. And I think this piece right here, which was a commission for Tony, took maybe like 10 minutes or so to render on my very beefy CPU, which is kind of embarrassing if you think about how much faster you can make it. It's like, it's very inefficient. And there's all sorts of techniques that I think I like stumble across later on that make it much faster. But these basically came from actually initially like a fascination with this guy, Mark Lovejoy. And obviously like the pieces that I wound up producing here, they don't look like these. Like these are like clearly done in a physical medium. They're like, I think fundamentally very different, but I remember seeing these, I don't even know where, but I saw these and I was immediately fascinated by just how rich and beautiful one, the colors were, and then two, the shapes were. And I think that like seeing that sort of inspired me to wonder like, well, if you do it from like a computer oriented way where like the goal, at least for me, is never to like perfectly replicate some physical phenomena, because I think, well, one, we can always just use the physical phenomena if we wanted to. Like, I think if my goal was to perfectly reproduce Mark Lovejoy's work, I'd probably try to start with paint. Like, I wouldn't do it on the computer, but, and that usually develops into a lot of research and a lot of playing with the code and trying to find a way to represent these things digitally. And then generally, as a result, you never really quite get there, but you get somewhere interesting, and that gives you a place to play around and to explore and find something that inspires you.
Yeah, no, these are absolutely beautiful, what you're showing on screen here, the Mark Lovejoy works. And so how did you, you know, given that you weren't trying to perfectly replicate these, how did you think about your paint mixing algorithm and how, I guess, closely you wanted to replicate that while still putting a nod to the medium with code?
Yeah, no, I think, well, the initial thing that I was kind of fascinated with was, well, how do we even just get close to producing like the something that looks like paint, something that sort of has the same fluidity and the same, I guess, contours and the same general shapes that look like something like it isn't, it's clearly not paint. It's clearly not like paint that's mixing. But I think if you showed this to someone and you ask them what it was, you probably get some guesses of like, well, it looks a little bit like paint that's being stirred, and that's definitely where these things start. But where it then led me to was, and I think it's might be visible in one of these pieces if we zoom in. Early on, I was kind of playing with different ways of, this is annoying, let's see if we, yeah, here. I was playing with like, so these were actually rendered as SVGs, and they were like multiple layers and they had different opacities. And something that I was really frustrated with was when these different layers of different opacities were mixing, when they mix in RGB space, which is just the way these things get mixed when you set opacities, they produce like consistent, but honestly, objectively, sometimes kind of ugly results. Like if you, for example, have blue and yellow and you mix them in RGB space, like you kind of see is happening here, Your eyes might be playing a trick on you, and you might see maybe something slightly bluish or something slightly greenish. But if you look very closely, it's actually closer to gray. And like if you have real paint, that's not what you would expect. And I mean, that's not to say that the way paints mix is the best way that color should mix. But at the very least, I was kind of interested in this idea of like, well, how do we find more aesthetically pleasing ways of mixing these colors? And what that led into was like a long, like several months spent studying how colors mix and how paints mix. And there's one theory developed surprisingly in the 1930s by this pair of physicists, Kubelka and Monk, and it's named Kubelka-Monk theory, that describes how pigments mix and how they reflect and scatter incoming light based on their spectral distributions. So if we take a look.
And that, I assume, was a study in, well, of course, but in the 1930s in analog, like real life paint.
Exactly, yeah. And the remarkable thing, let's see, that happens here is that in order to like fully verify this theory and to apply it physically, you have to derive these spectral coefficients for the paints that you're dealing with, which is actually computationally very expensive. And I think the first group that did it was this lab under Roy Burns, and I can show you the master's thesis where this was done.
Wow, so you really went deep, huh? How did you even find that?
This was like months and months of Googling, basically. Well, let's see if we can even find it again here. Actual master's, what do I look for? That's the one. And if you're listening to this and you're curious how all this works, this master's in particular is a really great introduction to the subject. And it describes the background and describes the process for collecting these coefficients. However, and this is something I've probably talked about too many times now, but the actual coefficients themselves, they're all plotted down here. So you can get a sense for like the reflectance and the scattering coefficients. But to get them with enough detail to actually perform the paint mixing, they're not published here yet. I had to reach out to the professor and then also get clearance from the paint manufacturer that these coefficients are based on, which is Golden Acrylics. And they're very generous to let me use these for work that I was going to sell, under the one condition that I don't share the coefficients further. The reason being that they, I think in theory, my understanding is you can use the coefficients to then reproduce on a chemical level the actual paint. So they're basically the intellectual property of the paint manufacturer. So.
Ah, super interesting. Okay. And that allowed you to represent the way that the colors would mix in a realistic fashion based on these coefficients. Is that right?
Exactly. Which is, I think, in some sense also maybe kind of interesting here, where, so like there's one piece here that I think shows this very well, or has like a nice example of where this mixing is happening. And it's piece number 18, and it's owned by AOI, where let's open this on a separate tab. If we really zoom in and we look right here, what the code's doing is it has like multiple buffers that it's writing the paint concentration to. And in this case, you can see it's mixing this blue in various gradations with this particular yellow. You can actually see some really beautiful and different shades of green in here. And it's interesting because obviously like the paints aren't mixing like they do in real life. Like they're flat. They have like hard defined boundaries. They don't have any gradations within them, but that's definitely very intentional, as it's kind of an interesting play on the medium in a purely digital sense, where at the same time, you still see like echoes of this, for example, in these shades of green, these gradations, where clearly the mixing is happening, but it's not visible like we see in the physical world. And I think that's that's one thing that I guess excites me and really, gets me hyped up about these particular pieces here.
This is so cool. I mean, so for folks who may not know, we're looking at the How You See Me series that Lars released on Object as one of ones. This is when I first really like heard your name and started noticing. I'm embarrassed to say I didn't hear it earlier, but I'm working on my methodologies for finding new artists sooner. But I remember seeing these and I was like, wow, these are unbelievably good. And you know, the word like clean or crisp and other non-artistic, non-specific words came into my mind when I was looking at this. And as you're explaining this, it makes sense. I mean, you know, if you're getting to that level of detail, I think that it's hard to appreciate why something catches your eye, but you're really getting into the weeds here. I mean, you're the paper you referenced was 192 pages, right? I mean, this is like some serious level of research. So first of all, thank you for sharing. This is unbelievable. I hadn't noticed this on the Zoom, the close-up, and I'm curious, like, in the print, does it come out like this? Because, I mean, for the physical print, you actually are mixing paint, right? Or at least inkjet. I'm going to stop embarrassing myself because I don't know exactly how it works. But does it come out like this, or does it come out what you would, you know, does the digital representation end up translating into the analog, given that you did do some things that in theory were not physically possible as you were creating this?
Yeah. Well, it's kind of funny, right? Like the whole, like there's this constant re-representation that happens in digital media where even seeing the same piece in different screens, you'll see the colors represented slightly differently. And when you print, the colors are then translated by the printer into yet another format and then printed according to whatever methodology the printer uses, where even those colors won't exactly match what you see on the screen. And that's, I guess in some ways like an unfortunate side effect of the medium, where you can only really ever get so close, and you have to sort of accept that if you print these, you're only going to get so close to the colors in the end. But that's also not the goal here, is to like perfectly represent the colors, but instead it's much more about balancing the relationships between the colors and how they look next to each other. And that's something that sort of regardless of how you show it, the screen or the printer is going to do a good job of. I think what the printer's doing in the end is much closer to how colors mix in reality, where it's when you, or not in reality, but how they mix with paint. If you are dealing with your screen, it's an additive process where you mix colors by sort of adding one wavelength on top of the other, and both wavelengths are then present when you wind up showing the image. Whereas when you do it in physical media, it's subtractive, and you wind up using pigments to only reflect the wavelengths that are, I guess, reflected by that particular pigment, which is, in a certain sense, like the inverse process from what the screen does. Unfortunately, we have our printers to do all that complicated calculation, and they're heavily pre-calibrated, and the drivers that these like fancy printers use are like a lot of, way more research goes into those than the research that even goes into these pieces. So I'm very fortunate for the folks at HP and Epson and all them to make this easy for us to use. But it's a good question. Yeah, like it is an interesting thing that happens where these same works get re-represented between like your phone screen and your computer screen and the print and all the many ways that you can wind up showing this work.
Yeah, no, this is unbelievable and super cool. Like this feels like a privilege to even have the chance to talk to you about this, and I'm sure the listeners will enjoy hearing about these techniques and how in depth you went and how thoughtful you've been about this. And you know, you have a few other projects. You have Lions Walking, which was Applaudables. We didn't cover Gossamer or Unfolded. I'd love to just hear if there's anything you wanted to highlight from those projects before we move on to what you're looking to next, because I really want to get to that too. But yeah, anything about some of those other ones that are favorites or that you want to highlight for folks listening?
Yeah, well, I guess maybe one thing I'd like to point out, because I've always been meaning to do a more in-depth write-up for Geode and Unfolded, but Unfolded in particular, I feel like it's an interesting one to me because it's It's about like pattern exploration guided by a computer, where the patterns that you see are generated by this algorithm that I wrote for simulating how paper gets folded. And I mean, maybe it's obvious from the name, but I think all the shapes and the creases and the valleys and the crests come from computer code, basically taking a square, folding it up a certain number of times according to a pattern based on the traits, and then unfolding it, and then using that resulting pattern and sort of repetitions in that pattern and repetitions and which side of the paper that the fold ended up on to actually wind up assigning the colors, which it's still something I want to do a more in-depth write-up on to sort of explain the process and share the algorithms that other people can use it to if they want to play with algorithmic paper folding. But I think it's something that I've been dying to talk about, but just haven't had the time to.
Oh man, you know what's funny? We just interviewed James Merrill 2 days ago, who did the Artbox curated in Ori. And that is, I'm sure it's, there's way, way more nuance, but the core of that algorithm is also folding paper along a plane and then playing around with that. So you all should talk sometime. I'm sure you would have a lot of fun chatting about that. But I love these. Unfolders are beautiful. I actually, of your FX hash collections, this one was my favorite. I don't know why. I was just really drawn to it. And I love how you integrated the color into this. And I'm curious, since we're on this page, you know, you mentioned that it's different ways that this square could be folded, and then it's kind of folded back open and you have the various creases. How did you think about the color patterning and how that patterning might be imprinted on those folds?
Yeah. It's, I feel like when I, at least at the time, and I still feel this way now when I try to use color, and maybe this comes from my day job where we have to use color as a means for conveying information. I feel like I want the color and the intensity of some section of the image to correspond to some meaning, which is something that's like creatively you're afforded to do with a computer because you can write rules about how a certain object gets colored. And maybe by definition, that's how it works with computer art. But here the colors and the intensities are assigned by basically looking at the end after you've unfolded the sheet of paper. You have all these different chunks, and there are these like different convex shapes that, for example, if we take a look at this one right here, like you can see all these kind of boundaries defining these shapes that are all equally colored and have like sort of equally shaped textures within them. When those pieces are first created and folded, they always end up either on the top of a fold or on the bottom of a fold. And that process is repeated where you keep on doing it. And of course, when you do your first fold, which you can always identify here by, it's usually the one that is completely uninterrupted and runs from one edge of the page to the other. Obviously, this shape isn't visible then in the folding pattern, but by the time it's done, that particular subsection of the paper that you're folding has always either been on the top or the bottom of every fold. And you can take that top-bottom sequence as a binary string and then create a rule that says every binary string that matches this pattern gets a certain color. So in the end, the colors come from that particular sequence of folding and unfolding that happens, which then surfaces itself by having, in many cases, like very structured and regular repeating patterns of color that are then broken up by the particular folding and unfolding sequence that happens. So there's the colors aren't random, but they're also not immediately obvious either where they come from. And that's how the colors get assigned here.
Oh, this is so cool. And you know, we started off Collector's Corner by doing deep dives into specific projects. I feel like we could go deep into all of the various nuances of this project and of Geode and of a few of your other ones. But yeah, so this is super cool. And maybe we'll have you back on sometime and we can go like deeper into any of these. But I do want to ask you about what you're exploring next. And maybe you could show some of the work in progress as you've had up on Twitter. because they're so good. And of course, like, I'm speaking from a very visual standpoint. I don't know anything about the code. I'm just curious, like, what are you exploring these days? And these outputs you've been teasing on Twitter, like, what, you know, looks like almost like a mix. Like, you have some geometry in there, of course, they look 3D, but you have these brilliant colors mixed in, which seem to be another evolution of how you see me. But I'll stop trying to guess, and I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah, no, I'd love to share. I like that you said how you see me for the colors, because the final step for determining those colors is basically taking that spectral representation and turning it into an RGB color. And I'm taking that same approach, and I'm using it to assign colors within what I'm calling a spectral ray tracer, where, so typically, so ray tracing is like a very common technique in computer graphics. And actually, let me just pull up one of the pictures as a background here. So I guess, yeah, this is a live a render here, where in computer graphics, what you're doing is you're basically taking from the perspective of a camera, you're shooting. It's kind of like the reverse process of what you do if you have a scene in physical reality. You shoot rays out from the camera, and you look, and you have them leave the camera and then bounce around the scene until they find a light source, and all along the way record how much light was absorbed by every material they hit and how much light's being reflected there or emitted there, to then decide what color that particular pixel will be. And for the sake of efficiency and the sake of being able to render things either in real time or in reasonable amounts of time, it's way cheaper to do these things only looking at RGB colors. Because we're making art, we're not trying to just make the most efficient image possible. What I'm doing here is, for every single wavelength, I'm associating a phase, and sorry, for every single ray, I'm associating a wavelength and a phase, which once you shoot enough rays out from a single pixel, you can use those to basically build up what's called a spectral power distribution, and you can translate that into an RGB color. And in these particular images here, maybe we can look at a few of them as they render. And they run, I guess it's maybe not captured great on the zoom here, but they do run in real time, and they and the code's constantly evolving, so it's hard to say exactly where it is now or where it'll be whenever it gets released on whatever platform it winds up. But they're basically scenes that are set with just one or two spheres that are either reflecting or refracting light. And the rules of the reflection and the refraction are heavily dependent on the wavelength, which then creates these very rich rainbow structures that then become visible here, where sometimes you get some very monochrome palettes like this, and you can sort of see, I'm not sure if it's super visible, but you go from a very noisy image at the start, where as the renderer keeps running, it keeps collecting more samples and winds up producing calculating for every pixel what the final color should be based on the average of very many samples that it shoots out. So you go from like very grainy, noisy, kind of like a film camera, to something very smooth as the renderer keeps running. And we can look through some sample images here. Let's see.
These are beautiful. And for anyone who's listening on audio, just stop and go on YouTube, because you absolutely have to see these. And did I hear you right, Lars, that these are constantly evolving in a sense that they're constantly cycling and like rendering, or is it just that initial rendering process and then it gets to a static image?
What I meant to say was the code I'm constantly evolving. So I think whatever I'm showing here is not maybe necessarily a reflection of where it'll end up. But these do, in theory, these can run forever. So you could have one constantly running and layering more and more light to build more and more intricacy and structure. And that was something I explored for some time, but realized that the longer you let it run, sort of the noisier it gets. And I haven't found a good happy medium between like letting it run forever and actually producing interesting things along the way. I think right now it's producing nice things after like a couple seconds, and that's usually where I leave it. But this image right here, go ahead.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Yeah, I'm just, so what got you curious about this? And I love how you're explaining this in depth, and my brain's still catching up with what you're saying. So I'm gonna have to go back and listen to this again in terms of the details of how the colors are manifest and how they evolve based on like the pixels around them. But what was the goal here that you wanted to explore? What got you curious about this?
The where it started was seeing light just passing through a glass, like a glass of water or a window pane, and then seeing the kinds of patterns that were showing up on the surface behind it, which is something I later learned is called caustics, which is basically those like light patterns that form when you run them through some refractive medium like that. And I feel like they're kind of like a great example of something that you can explore with computer art, because on one hand, you can do this very much in parallel, like it's very friendly to the GPU to sort of cast these things out in parallel and independently to compute your final image. But then also they're sort of a source of unexpected and very rich complexity that arises from doing this, where you have, like I was showing, a very simple scene with maybe one or two spheres. But if you sort of mess with the rules a little bit in a way that you can really only do with a computer and explore a system in a way that you only can with the help of simulation and computation, you get these very rich and varied systems that that I think are, to me, like what excites me about computer art. I think hopefully maybe this helps explain a little more what's going on here, where this is like the very first image produced by that spectral ray tracer, where it's for every wavelength building the associated color. And you can kind of see it dip off into a darker shade here, where I think this is happening because her eyes are just less sensitive to the very long red wavelengths, and the blues even get a little darker here, where they're kind of dipping into the ultraviolet. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say it's beautiful. Like I was thinking that, you know, you're probably getting into the infrared spectrum where we can't see it anymore. I don't know if the computer emits it at that point. This is extremely captivating, and the color study that you're doing here is so cool. Where do you want to take this? I know you have some of these works in progress you're showing. Do you think that this is going to be an exploration you'll do for a while? Or are you thinking this is kind of a shorter thing? Maybe you do a couple projects on this and then other stuff in the works?
Yeah, so there's actually a few of these pieces that were produced in the process that when I showed them to Sophia and Tony, they just absolutely loved them. I always feel like it's fun to work on these things for a long time, because you can produce, you can just keep exploring and finding more and more interesting things. But we found six pieces here along the way that all three of us really liked. And what we're actually doing right now, and I think this is the 31st of January, it's closing right now. We're doing a private auction for a few of the people that over time have been asking for the opportunity to collect one of these pieces. And it's a private auction, so it's a sealed bid auction, so nobody knows what anyone's bidding. And we're using the second highest bidder to set the price for the winner. So it's the tough thing with these private auctions is that it's like you don't know what to bid. It's maybe scary to overbid in these cases. So doing second highest bidder makes things maybe a little more fair and a little less expensive, where I'm kind of afraid, maybe this is going back to the earlier discussion about like pacing and career, to have prices rise too quickly. And I wouldn't want to create a situation where all of a sudden, because there's a lot of hype, a piece sells for a bunch, and then there's an expectation for other pieces to sell that much. So hopefully by doing this privately and in a sealed bid second highest price auction, the hype is maintained at a reasonable level, and these sell for something more reasonable.
Yeah, no, that's smart. It's funny that you talk about the the blind auction, because as I mentioned earlier, I recently bought a house, and it, you know, that's kind of like a blind auction, so to speak, right? Like the house up on for sale. And I remember thinking, like, why do they do it this way? Like, this is so annoying. Like, it should be just like NFTs where I could just see what other people are bidding. But there's a place and a time for every type of these different mechanisms, for sure. And these are beautiful. I mean, congrats to the people who own them. And I'm curious, as you're thinking about, of course, you have to be smart about supply and all these other things that the artxcode folks are talking about. Do you see yourself doing another long form? So I say long twice, because I know you have your bright moments coming up, and that's 100 pieces. But do you see yourself doing a 300 plus collection again, or how are you thinking about that?
Yeah, no, well, I think I absolutely want to do an art box trough, whether it's curated or not. It would be just wonderful to get to release on their platform. It'll take some time for something to be ready for that. And then I think even once it's ready, there's going to be, or what I hear is that there's a fairly long pipeline between approval and then actually also being slotted in, because there's a long queue of projects that they already have, I think, ready and in the pipeline for release. So, and in that case, I think that odds are it would almost certainly be, like you say, a long form release, just because that's how it works for the platform. And I think some variation on this code, so something based on this concept of painting with light, where you're exploring the medium in a way that you really only can with a computer, because you're either bending the laws of physics in a way that aren't possible, or you're doing things in the scene that aren't geometrically feasible in the real world, but then still producing hopefully visually beautiful results is what I have in mind for an art box drop. But this is probably, I mean, honestly, at this point, it's probably more of a 2024 thing. Even if it was ready tomorrow, I think it would be a while before it actually gets released there.
How are you feeling about having your works sell for as much as they're selling for? We'll see, I'm sure, before this is released, what those auctions ended up at that are probably going to be. I mean, I remember the How You See Me's, and I remember feeling very priced out, especially as people like Kylo and Proper were bidding on them. And I was like, okay, yeah, like that's not going to happen for me now, type of a thing. But it must be crazy to go from a hobby just a few years ago to this. Like, how's it been?
Yeah, no, it's very surreal and very scary. Like, I on one hand, I want to be able to do this, these competing feelings of like, it's best to be able to do this as the only thing on my mind, like where all my creative energy goes. So obviously, like, has to make enough money so that I can pay rent and pay for food and all these things. So in that case, it's a great blessing to be able to have these sell for so much, because they really like they. It's more than just paying for food and rent. It's like actually really very privileged to have these sell for so much. But at the same time, it's very scary, because it feels like now there's an expectation that the future works also sell for that much. And that's, I mean, I understand from the collector's perspective, like if I spend a large sum of money on an artwork, I mean, of course it's unreasonable to expect every artwork to appreciate in value, because that's just impossible. Like that's not the way things work, but there is also like an understanding that you're not going to do something completely idiotic and destroy your own market, because that's not serving your own interests and that's not serving their interests. And it's, I guess you kind of feel caught between those two, where it looks like there's something to say.
No, I'm glad you bring this up, because, and I'm glad we're talking about it while we're recording, because it's an interesting point, right? And I think of like, there are levels, you know, I don't think it is realistic for Tyler Hobbs to expect that everything he releases now to be worth at least 100 ether, the way that Fidenzas are, right? I mean, it's just, it's gotten to a level where it's sort of like, you know, I think he should just focus. And I've never talked to Tyler, And if he listens, I would, you know, if I did, I'd tell him the same thing. Like, just focus on making really, really good work, right? Like, what got you here in the first place, and not worry as much about, like, it has to be worth more than Fidenza or all the other Fidenza collectors are going to be upset. Like, me as a collector, I'm not upset. Like, I'm a huge anti-cyclone collector. I love William LePond's work. I got a 1935, which is his Bright Moments drop. I'm not upset that the floor is not as high. I love his work. I think it's great. It's different. Fine. The crowd didn't like it as much, but it is what it is. I think as long as you're making a concerted effort to put out really consistently good work and it doesn't feel cash grabby, then that's all that reasonable collectors will care about. And I emphasize reasonable because you're always going to have some unreasonable people, right, who want like everything, right? I mean, who want it to go to $1 million tomorrow, and why isn't it happening yet? And I think you kind of have to just tune those people out because, you know, whatever, right? Like, you just don't have enough time for that. And I would just encourage you, I think, to, of course, you have like the artxcode team like helping you out, but I would also encourage you to follow your artistic intent and trust that you doing that and really following that is going to lead to good results, even if it doesn't happen right away, or even if it's not exactly what all the collectors want, because I mean, hey, it's what got you here in the first place.
I really appreciate that. Yeah. My hope 100% is that I can kind of just do wacky creative stuff that's fun. I guess if it sells for a lot of money, that's great for me, but I guess, of course, in the back of my mind is always the sense that, like, yeah, it comes with the responsibility too. Of
what's cool, sorry to cut you off, is you can, in this world, you can always create some fake name and drop it on like FX hash and nobody ever knows it's you, and you never have to tell anybody, and you can just kind of see, and then that way get stuff out there that makes people happy without having any sort of reverberations on what you've done so far.
100%. Yeah, no, I think that's actually very tempting. Who knows, maybe I've done it, maybe I will do it. I won't be able to comment on that.
You know, it's so funny, the speculator's premium we have, right? Like, I've thought about, what if an artist really just released something that was brilliant and never told anybody who it was, and they just never told anybody? And it's like, we're seeing this right now with these friendship bracelets on Art Blocks that got released, and like Snowfro and everybody in Art Blocks has been extremely clear, this is nothing but a gift, it's never going to be anything but a gift, but that's it. And just the crowd's mind is turning it into something else. And in some ways it's beautiful like that, because it becomes truly a community project in that way, because we assign meaning to it. And I think sometimes just letting things exist like that might be a better path. That's not the goal, right? Your goal is probably, I'm sure, to express yourself artistically and see how people feel about it and relate to it. But, you know, just a thought out there. But to your point, some of your works are now selling for a really well-deserved amount of money, but certainly a lot of money. Have you started collecting? Like, I'm curious to hear about Lars the collector, you know, or now that perhaps you have some money that you feel like you can spend in that way. What do you like to collect? And if not, have you thought about it? And what kind of stuff tends to catch your eye, even if you haven't bought it?
100%. No, I collect a ton on FX hash and object. Those are like my favorite playgrounds to go and explore and collect. And I mean, I can pull up my...
We can see in the wallet.
And I think, yeah, it's a huge range, basically. I have a bunch of like many pages of art to go through, and it's a mix. Like, some of it's stuff, like, it's an artist that I want to support, like an artist who I respect who they are and I respect what they do, and I just want to buy their works. And of course, there's many artists too that I respect and love and adore, but buying their works would just be too expensive, because it's like, I would love to own a Ringers, for example, but like, to me, that's like the pinnacle of like long form generative, I think, is the Ringers project, but that's just sort of out of my price range still. So, but it's a huge range. It's it'll be tough to give shout outs, because I think like for every project you shout out, there's a million others that you miss. But I guess while we're looking at this page, like, for example, Soft Ice, like, I think, by Anatoly Zenkov, it's a great example of like something creative. Like one is interactive too, which I like. And it's like, it's wacky, it's fun, it's playful, it's got great use of color. It's like, I think this is a fantastic project. It has a pretty small edition size. It's on FX Hash. I'll also say that I've only sold one piece ever that I've collected, which was something that was airdropped, and it has like a million editions, and then it was blowing up my object notifications. So I apologize. I had to sell that. I didn't want that in my wallet. It was also kind of profane. So it was like one of those, like, wasn't a huge fan of it. But so I'll be pumping up some projects, but I have no intention of I guess profiting off of that. It's obviously not financial advice.
It's of course, yeah. We have a very long no financial advice disclaimer at the end of all our episodes, so can always reiterate it. And it's okay to sell stuff too. I mean, I think, let's put it this way. I think you as an artist are probably okay if somebody like has a piece, they take care of it and they sell it, and then somebody else can enjoy it and take care of it, etc. And in that way, it spreads, and they can use that capital to go support another artist or whatever, you know.
So true. No, in fact, actually, I love seeing, like, there's some folks who minted the first Gossamers like over a year ago and are now selling them for like 100x profit. And that makes me actually very happy, because they really like the work. They held on to it for a while, and they, I guess, are rewarded for that. And I can't fault them. And even if they sell for a loss, like, I can't hold them for, I don't know, like, you buy and sell what you want. I guess I just meant I don't want to be coming on here like hyping up a couple of projects and then seeming like I'm gonna sell the few that I got really excited about. But
not at all. Obviously, and I want to call one out that I really love. You have down there Plottable Era 1 Primitives. I love that collection. Like, huge web, fan.
Big fan of this guy. He's really sweet. He does Twitch streams. Did I open the right one? And actually, really, this project in particular, I think is like a wonderful, like, he has, it's actually really interesting. Like, he has like an identifiable style that he's been building, and I think in this case, like, really put it to use to great effect to produce these landscapes here. And I'm big fan of Gerweb, really sweet guy, really a nice contributor to the community. And I was very happy to collect this one. I think I missed this one on primary, but picked this one up on secondary. And
as did I. I mean, I've recently started getting more into plottables, and his plottable work feels unique in the sense that it I don't see a lot of plottables like this, and especially with the color and the way he does the reflections is beautiful. I really enjoy this project a lot.
Likewise, 100%.
Yeah, and while I got you, I got to ask. I know I interrupted you, but I'd love to hear some of the other ones that catch your eye, or some of the artists.
Yeah, I mean, really all of these do. It's hard to call anyone out, but maybe we can just page through some others. Let's see. I'm a big fan of what Alejandro is doing too with Infantines. He says, actually, it's really sweet that the interview that I did with Verse was what inspired him to look into color mixing. And actually, what he's using here was one of the there's a paper published by these folks, Secret Weapons. They publish this paper, Mixbox, and they have code available for commercial use if you pay for a license. So if you reach out to them, they can send you a copy of the code, and you can pay, I think, some, it's either a flat rate or some fixed percentage of your expected income. And he's using that here to actually do the color mixing. So it's, in a certain sense, maybe like a distant cousin of how you seen these, which makes me very happy. So I was very happy. Well, one, he sent this as a gift, which is very sweet of him. But then I was also really happy to collect Infantines 1 and 2, which the first one's probably further back in my wallet. But yeah, big fan of these here. Let's see. They're right here. Eric Swan, brilliant. Really great. Punk Weld, so good. I love this. This is like a great example of, at least to me, like very abstract geometry that you can produce with computer code. And then he does these wonderful things too, and layering and colors, and really big fan of this project.
And you know, this is one where I feel like it'd be just unbelievable in real life. You know, like, the print of this would be so, not that this is not, but like, it feels like it would really lend itself to being printed.
Totally agree. I think these would make some, I I should probably print some. Maybe I'll reach out to him to see if he approves of me printing one of these. But yeah, 100% agree. These are stunning, and the detail on these is fantastic. I think like it's one of those where it really lends itself to looking closely and then enjoying the detail up close, and then stepping away and seeing the composition as a whole. I think Eric did a really fantastic job with these here.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I won't make you go through your whole wallet. We can link to it so people can see what you like and what you've collected without you having to potentially bias folks on here. Oh, I see a nano panorama. Those are amazing too. But yeah, you know, I wanted to ask you just to respect your time. Like, are there any like parting thoughts you have or anything else you'd like to say to the audience?
Ooh, that's tough. I guess I'm just really thankful for this opportunity, both to be on the show, but even like more broadly speaking, to get to do this full time now going forward. So I'm incredibly excited. I can't wait to see what's going to happen. I think it's a wonderful space, and it's filled with a community of wonderful people.
Well, yeah, and we can't wait to see what more you bring out, Lars. I mean, I think from this interview, it was clear to me even before this interview how much time you take into your craft, and now seeing the depths that you went into to explore this out of really just intrinsic exploration is amazing. And you're doing that part time while having a demanding job. I know you said you're having a lot of fun, but everybody knows that Google is not the, you know, it's not a 9-to-5 type of thing. So I'm like crazy excited to see what you're going to be coming up with now that you're full time, and really curious to hear, you know, like to see Lars unleashed, I guess, and hear how it's going for you. So I want to really thank you for taking the time, and we'll link to your Twitter and your at Lars Wander. We'll link to all of the stuff that you showcased here. And just really appreciate you taking the time and sharing with everybody. Like, it's fantastic, and we're so happy to have you in the community.
Thank you. I love to share. You've been a wonderful host, P. Thank you.
All right. Well, until then, everybody, we'll see you next time. Thank you for tuning into Collector's Corner. We really appreciate you taking the time to listen. If you like this episode and want to help us out, please subscribe and leave us a review on your podcasting platform of choice, like Apple Podcasts and Spotify, and follow us on YouTube. Please also follow us on Twitter for announcements as we expand to other social and content platforms. Our Twitter handle is @collectors_XYZ. We'd also love to hear any feedback you have, so please comment or reach out. We're always striving to be more useful and get better so we can help you in your collecting journey. The Collector's Corner team and their guests are not registered investment advisors. All views expressed on this podcast are personal opinions and are not specific inducements to make particular investments or investment strategies, and should not be relied upon for investment decisions. This show is solely for informational and entertainment purposes only. Before making any financial decisions, please consult a professional.